Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV Online original webinar series. Today we have my very good friend, Dr. Harshad Argekar. He is an associate professor in Cooper Medical College. He is a very good trauma surgeon and he specializes in trauma and hip surgeries. He is going to talk today on implant removal tips and tricks, how to remove broken screws. This webinar is brought to us by an unrestricted educational grant from GSK Consumer, the makers of Iodex Ultra Gel. Over to Dr. Harshad.
Thank you, Neeraj, for the very kind introduction. And good evening, all friends. We are happy to be presenting on Ortho TV. This is a good online platform for a long-term repository of your data. Plus, you are getting enough educational information and that too at a pretty nominal cost. So, I would like to share my screen with you right now. I'm going to talk about removal of screws, a situation which we encounter very commonly, where our screws are in the plate and for some reasons, because of technical problems, sometimes screws don't come up. They don't come out. And this happens very commonly, especially if you are removing an implant which has been put by somebody else, or the implant has been put many years ago and you are removing it after a long time. Also, if you have implants which are substandard quality, sometimes the head just shears off or breaks off, or in situations where there is implant failure. Therefore, the screws have broken off and you will find it difficult to remove and you are stuck. So what I'll be talking about is some tips and tricks which you can follow and how you can get yourself ready to encounter such a thing. If you encounter such a situation, how can you counter such a situation? So whenever I put an implant, I always put an implant with a plan in mind that in the future I will have to remove it. So during implant removal, implant insertion, I take proper precautions to see to it that my implant removal becomes easier. So ideally, a person who is putting the implant should be the one to remove it. And when you put an implant, you have to keep it in mind that either you or somebody in the future will have to take it up. So first important thing which you have to do is a clear documentation of the implant. Nowadays, a lot of implants have different types of screw heads. Not all screw heads are hexagonal. There is a star drive which has come up very recently. And certain implant companies specifically have these star drives for all their implants. So it is very necessary for you while putting the implant to clearly mention which company the implant you put in. And especially if the screw head is a star drive, you have to take special precautions to mention that. Now, this is a video of showing how not to use your screwdriver. If you see the first part of the video, the screwdriver is kept at an angle to the screw head and then it is rotated. If it is kept at an angle, the screw head will turn round. You should ideally not keep it at an angle. Also, when you're removing the screw, see to it that all the soft tissues around the screw are completely removed. This white fibrous nubbin is generally present inside the screw recess, and unless it is removed, your screw head will not engage. So it is very important to not have the screw head halfway out. The screwdriver should be completely going inside the screw head so that the recess is completely engaged, the hexagonal head, and only then you attempt to remove. If your screw head is halfway out, it will cause the screw head to become round and make implant removal difficult. When you are inserting the screw head, especially in the locking configuration, you have to ensure that you don't get this cold weld. So this cold weld will happen if your screw is not at perfect angle to the locking threads. So important that you should use proper instrumentation, especially the drill sleeve, and then engage your head in the proper direction without changing the angle. So as of today, there are various types of screw heads available. We started from the slotted ones, then went to the Phillips head, and then the hexagonal head, which is most common. But nowadays, most screw heads are become into the star drive or the torox type of a configuration, because this has got the least torque in order to strip the screw head. So torox, I feel, is going to be the future of all screw heads, maybe 4 or 5 years from now. So what problems can you encounter when you are trying to remove a screw head? If your screw head is stripped, that means it has become round, then your screwdriver won't fix. Otherwise, the screw head can break off, or proximal portion of the screw will be removed, but the screw is broken in its body, and the distal portion of the screw, which is attached to the far cortex, may be left behind. So these are the three problems which I will tell you how to deal. So generally what happens is, when your screwdriver is not in proper position and you try and make a turn and the screwdriver slips, that is a troublesome situation. But every time then you try and remove it, the chances of removal become reduced by 50%. So if you try and, if it slips once and you keep on turning, it is going to make the head rounder and rounder. So ideally, if it slips once, you should just wait and reassess the situation and do something else rather than just trying to strip off the head. So here I have found sometimes this is a suture pack which you have, which is a metallic device, will make it easier. I'll just show you the picture, the video. The screw head is round and a screwdriver is just rotating. This is a metal foil of your suture pack or suture material. This you can use as a packer or you can use as a filler. And if you use it, sometimes the screw head will get a better grip and you will be able to take it out. This is not successful every time, but it will help to act as a filler between your screw head and the rounded, just rounded screw head, and will be helping you to remove it. Otherwise, you have the screw head gripper. This instrument is available in most screw removal implant sets, or you can have this kind of a screw vice grip, which is available in the hardware market. You can have this autoclaved and ready, and you can use this to grip the screw head to take it out. If you have an old nibbler whose tip is broken or it is spoiled, you can use this nibbler also. Like for example, I had this broken nibbler and I modified it little bit by taking it to the hacksaw and cutting the tip edge. So I made it flat. And now if you see, it has got a rounded inner surface, which will help me to grip the screw heads. And this will help me to remove an implant by getting a proper grip. A new nibbler, if you use, you are surely going to spoil it. But if you have a spoiled nibbler, keep it in your implant removal set. It will save the day in order to grip the screw head. That's how the screw can be removed. Now, there are professional instruments available for this purpose. So you have a carbide drill bit, which is a metal cutting drill bit, and certain taps, which is a reverse threading tap, available from various companies. The Shirsagar is one of the most popular companies. They are exporting all over the world also this instrument. So you can use a specific tap and a specific drill. So I'll show you, this is a metal cutting drill. And you drill it, you can remove the entire inner threading of the screw, making it perfectly round. So if you can see a zoomed image, a hexagonal screw head has now become perfectly round. And you can see the metal shavings which the drill bit has removed. And then you can use the tap. Now this is a reverse threading tap. You just put it in the anti-clockwise direction. This tap will cut a thread hole in the screw head, and as you turn in the anti-clockwise direction, it will pull the screw out also. This is a very, very useful instrument in removing rounded screw heads. So it's a reverse metal threading tap, and this will get the screw head out. This is a clinical use of the same instrument. You can see the screw head easily comes out even if it is rounded. sometimes the grip on the screw is so hard that it is difficult to disconnect this tap from the screw head. So you have to actually grip the screw with a plier and then try and remove the tap out. It is a really, really a strong grip, especially if you have a new reverse threaded tap. So various screws have various sizes of tap. This is for the 4.5 non-locking. This is for 5mm locking. This is for a 3.5 non-locking. And this is for a 2.5 locking non-locking thread. Each one comes with its own drill bit. So you'll have to have the whole set in with you in order to deal with various types of situations. Now, reverse metal threading drill bits are also available in the hardware store. You can easily get it on the internet. I have a set of these which I bought from YouTube, from Amazon, for a very cheap price. This, of course, is not as good as the professional ones, but in a backup situation, in a stuck situation, these will bail you out, and they are pretty inexpensive. You can get a wide choice anywhere on Amazon or any website, and you can just order it if you want to keep it as a backup. So this is the AO. These two are the ones which are available on the internet. And they work fine. You require a reverse drill along with it. This doesn't come with a handle. So if you have a reverse drill, you can easily use this for situations where you're stuck. Now, second scenario, if the screw head is broken. Now, in this situation, because the head is broken, you can't really use a reverse tap because there is nothing to hold the head. So in this scenario, even your screw holder or your head holder will simply slip off because it will have no grip. There is nothing to grip. In this situation, what you need to do is to make space by gouging out the near cortex. Once you gouge it out using a bone gouge, you can possibly get a better grip. So use a bone gouge to make space around this screw head, around the screw shaft, and then use a gripper or some such instruments to gradually take it out thread by thread. Once so much is out, it is very easy to remove the subsequent portion. Now the third situation, which is a little more difficult, if the near part of the screw is broken and only the distal part of the screw is remaining, which is attached to the distal cortex, this I feel is one of the most difficult situations to deal with. Here you require special instruments. Here you can't use a gouge, you can't use a drill bit. Here you require hollow mills. Now what these hollow mills do is they make a drill around the screw shaft. The hollow mill size is just bigger than the shaft of the screw, and this hollow mill will thread a hole around the broken screw. And of course, you require to use a reverse drill for this. You can't use a forward drill. You require a reverse drill. And this reverse drill will then pour out a hole around the broken screw. And if the screw is engaged within the hollow mill, there is a facility for that to happen. Then while you're drilling it or while you're reverse cutting it, the screw shaft may come out on its own. So if the screw is engaged into the hollow mill, it comes out on its own, or there are specialized thread gripper devices. These are available in the AO set. If you create a hollow mill and create a space around the broken screw, you can use this reverse thread gripper. It again is used in a reverse direction. It has got threads inside which will grip the broken screw and then take it out. So these are the methods by which you can retrieve a distally broken screw. Of course, if the distally broken screw is protruding on the other side of the cortex, you can take an incision on the opposite side and take out the screw from the other side, but it may not be feasible in all clinical scenarios. So I have a dedicated set of instruments which I keep for my implant removal. It has got a pointed device which can create a hole around my screw. It has got a gouge. I've got fine point suction tips in order to see my screw. Sometimes very difficult to see because of that detection. I have a broken or an old disc punch which I can use to retrieve from areas which are narrow. Then I have these metal cutting drill bits. I've got my screw head gripper. I've got grippers from the hardware store. I always keep a hacksaw. I've got hollow mills. And I've got these reverse threading taps which I can use to remove my screw head. For removal of screws, you require to have the best instrumentation. A broken screw cannot be removed with horrible instrumentation. You require good instrumentation in order to retrieve a broken screw, because a screw removal can take you a few hours also if you are really, really dedicated to remove it. If you have good instrumentation, this time can be cut short significantly. Of course, the commercially available reverse tap and the screwdriver and the drill bit, I feel, are really good. If you have this instrumentation in your inventory, the broken screw removal will become a breeze. It will be very easy. I thank you very much for patiently listening to this. If you have any questions, I will request Neeraj to ask me those on your behalf and I can answer them.
Thank you, Arshad. That was a very comprehensive coverage of broken screws and implant removal. We also have Dr. Abhijit Kale. So Dr. Abhijit Kale is an assistant professor in Sion Hospital. And so do you have any queries for a broken screw removal set or broken screw removal techniques? So I will ask my first query. So what you said now that when you do the reverse drilling, it sometimes gets badly stuck. It sometimes get badly stuck. Basically, the screw doesn't come out. So sometimes one of my times it has happened that I had to give up the instrument. It did not come out only.
Yeah.
Is there any tip to remove that broken screw out of the instrument?
What you can do rather than throwing it away, now if you are using a gripper on the other side and you are trying to take it out and it is not possible, and you are in such a situation where you are able to throw the instrument, I would suggest you autoclave it. Mm. Autoclaving will expand the instrumentation and then your screw head removal may become easy. So you take it out hot from the autoclave and put water on your tap so that the tap cools down but the screw remains hot, so that there is an expansion of the screw and contraction of your tap. And that you might be able to take it out at that
point. Maybe that is a good tip to say. So, how much time does it take? Basically, when a patient comes for implant removal, sometimes we think that it's a simple thing. But two screws can give us a lot of pain and maybe take 1.5 to 2 hours.
So, I always tell my anesthetist, they ask me how much time for implant removal. I say it is between 15 minutes to 4 hours. If it comes out, it will take 15 minutes. If it doesn't come out, it will take 4 hours. You give adequate anesthesia or you give proper anesthesia. You can't do it under short G and saying main 2 minute mein nikal dega. Unless you are removing it within 6 months of your insertion and you have put in the implant and you are sure that your screw head is not wrong. For me, it has happened. Whenever I say I will take the implant out fast, it will always take a longer time. So my suggestion, even to the patient, I tell this, that there is going to take time. In fact, sometimes while removal of implant, it takes more time than putting the implant. Your incision will be longer. Your stitches may be higher because in order to remove an implant, you need to explore. And there is a possibility that some implant which is broken, which I am not able to retrieve, I'll have to leave inside because I don't want to damage you more than what is necessary. And that decision, you will have to leave it to me because I will make the right decision at the right time.
We have a AO broken screw removal set, and yes, we also have a Midas Rex available in the market. Yes. How much do you adequate the use of such instruments?
So Midas Rex is an excellent instrumentation because Midas Rex has got metal cutting burrs if you have that attachment, and it is a high speed drill and it is a precision drill. So if you have a Midas Rex, making a track or making a hollow around your screw becomes very easy, and you can actually burr out the entire screw. If you have a good quality drill bit, you can actually make the screw into powder and actually take it out. Of course, that will take a long time for you to achieve that. But given a choice, a Midas-Rex for drilling and making an opening for insertion of your screw removal instrument is a better instrumentation. Of course, Midas-Rex minimum cost is 25 lakhs. And if you have to keep it only for screw removal, then I think you are over investing. If you are using the Midas-Rex for other instrument, other cases like tumor surgery, fine on a regular basis and still using it, then a Midas-Rex will definitely be a better instrument.
So because of cost constraint, majority of the orthopedic surgeons may not have access to such instruments. So are there any options in the Indian variant?
Indian variant burrs you can get. In fact, there are South Korean burrs which are not very expensive. The entire instrumentation will cost around 1.5 lakh rupees, which in today's date, I would not say is very, very expensive as compared to Midas-Rex. But of course, the RPM and the torque which you get in the Midas-Rex will not be available in these instrumentation. Indian burrs are available for 25 or 30,000 rupees also, in fact, cheaper also. So, if you have nothing, you can use these. But if you are really a high volume surgeon, then it is worthwhile to invest in the more expensive ones.
Okay. Do you have any more questions, Abhiji?
Yes, sir. Sir, it is said a good surgeon knows where to stop. So, when should a surgeon give up removing the implant?
It's a very, very good question, Abhiji. When should you give up removal of implants? So that all depends on what inventory you have, how much is your experience, and what is your patience in removing all these things. So if I have the AO set, the Midas-Rex and everything, then I will do all possible means to remove the broken screw. However, if I feel that my drilling the bone is going to make it weaker or my chances of creating an iatrogenic fracture is high. Now, there are no parameters for this, but if you are drilling it in a thin bone and you realize that you're going to have to remove more than say 20 or 30% of the cortex, then you are leaving the patient open for a subsequent iatrogenic fracture. Here in such scenarios, it is wiser, it is better to stop your work and come out as it is, because the first principle of medicine is do no harm. You should not cause more harm and keep your ego aside and don't overpromise the patient. This will happen only in a situation where you are guaranteed that I will remove the implant. You should never do that. It's a wrong, it's unethical to guarantee anything in medicine, especially implant removal. And if you want the patient and you want the relative that I may have to leave something back and interrupt, you're stuck, you go back to the relative or if the patient on the spinal anesthesia, you go back to him and tell him that I'm in a situation where I can cause you more harm by attempting to remove and I'm going to stop, I'm sure he's not going to he may be annoyed, but he can't do much about it, especially if you have taken proper consent before.
Sir, would you like the surgeons to add anything specific in the consent before taking this patient up for surgery?
Yeah, absolutely. Very, very important. Implant removal consent has to be individually written down or individually notarized. For example, if you are removing a nail, your consent will be separate. If you are removing a plate and screw, your consent will be separate. You have to mention two or three things. Number one, that somebody, if somebody else has done the implant, you have to mention that it has been done by somebody else and I am removing it at your request. It is not something which I have recommended. Second thing is the implant is more than 1.5 year old inside the body, then again you have to specifically mention that this is beyond 1.5 year old, which is a normal recommended time for implant removal. This is beyond that. Considering these two situations, there may be a problem in removing of your implant. I may have to abandon the surgery. However, having taken this consent and you don't have the proper instrumentation for removal, and then you go and remove and then you abandon the surgery, then you may be in trouble. So if you are removing a screw, you should have broken screw removal set. You can't say I don't have broken removal set and yet take the patient up for surgery. There you are opening yourself to liability, because court will ask you, if you didn't have the set, then why did you go ahead and do it? you should have anticipated that this problem will occur. It is a reasonable anticipation and you should have prepared for it. So now you can't abandon the surgery. You understand? So just consent will not protect you if you don't have the proper instrumentation. If you have an Indian burr, you have the Indian removal implant, it's fine. Because you have. At least you have it.
So, sir, the broken removal set that you mentioned.
Yes.
Does this screw removal set differ for a locking screw and a non-locking screw?
So, yes, a locking screw is different from a non-locking screw because the head is now engaged inside the plate. So, while removing a locking plate, you have to take double precautions. You have to take much, much more precautions than while removing a non-locking plate because there are two areas where the screw can get engaged. First, it can get engaged in the bone, and second, the screw can get engaged in the plate by the phenomena of cold fusion. Cold fusion is a known phenomena, especially with titanium implants. And if somebody else has used improper instrumentation, then cold fusion is a very high possibility. So while removing broken screw heads, now what I would recommend is that you have these carbon, the tungsten carbide drill bits. These carbide drill bits will actually cut a hole into the screw head. And once you completely destroy the screw head, only then can you disengage it from the plate. So these drill bits are extremely essential. And without these drill bits, don't go in for removal of a locking plate. It is not as easy as a non-locking plate. So in a locking plate, you have to be doubly prepared.
Vijay, do you have one more question?
Yes. For the new surgeons, the budding orthopedic surgeons who are just newly into the practice, in the initial year or two, they will end up removing more implants rather than putting inside implants. So what is your word of advice and caution for this budding orthopedic surgeons?
Yeah, for new orthopedic surgeons, because their practice is new and they are very keen on doing all these implant removals, most of them take up these surgeries. And your confidence is there now after residency. You suddenly are so confident that you can do anything in the world. So actually, you should temper that confidence. If you are in a situation where you have to remove an implant, my suggestion to you is take help of another colleague. See to it that your implant removal set is properly available, because if you fail to remove one implant, it will harm your reputation. So there is no harm in sharing your consulting fees or your operative fees with another colleague of yours who may be senior or who may be your own contemporary. But please see to it that you have those instrumentation ready. You can borrow it from senior surgeons who are your mentors. They will definitely help you out. And in such a situation, bail yourself out by having some colleague with you. And two minds will always think better than one, especially in a situation where you're stuck. Even today, when I'm removing an implant, I always take help of another colleague, because if you're stuck, sometimes your mind is not working and some new idea with some other colleague of yours will bail you out of this situation.
Word of advice, sir, from you. I think that the budding orthopedic surgeons, they will definitely be benefited from such words of wisdom. Over to you, Dr. Neeraj.
Okay. We thank Dr. Harshad for taking his precious time out, and we thank Dr. Abhijit Kale. Both are basically COVID warriors. They are working in hospitals where there are COVID patients admitted. One is in Sion Hospital, who is almost running to full capacity. The another one is Hooper Hospital. So stay safe, and we thank you all, and a good night to everyone.
Thank you very much, Neeraj.